Morning, everyone. Thank you to Paul for the introduction, and thank you to Malcolm and the team at A4G for inviting me here today. I want to spend some time this morning talking to you about how to recruit the best people for your business. As Malcolm's already mentioned today, there is the matrix, and getting the right people into your organisation is only going to help you to get the best efficiency for your organisation. So firstly, I want to start by looking at what is recruitment. It's not just about getting anyone with the skills that you need in your business to do a job. It's about finding the right person in the right place at the right time. You can't fit a square peg into a round hole. So just getting the skills isn't enough. You've got to make sure that that person's going to fit with your organisation. With recruitment, there are two areas of risk that I think people don't often think about, or they don't tend to think about. It can be seen as quite a risk-free process, but it's not. There's a risk that you might recruit the wrong person, and that can then be costly in terms of your time, managing that person, getting them either to the level that you want them or potentially managing them out of the business. And there's a risk with facing a claim from a disgruntled, unsuccessful candidate. There's the Equality Act 2010, which came in, which means it is illegal to discriminate against anyone on the grounds of sex, race, colour, nationality, age, sexual orientation, anything that you can think of, you can't discriminate on when it comes to recruitment. So those are things that you need to keep in mind when you are recruiting and you're making the decisions about the type of person that you're bringing into your business and the reasons why you are excluding people from the recruitment process. So what I want to cover is how we're going to avoid this. First of all, let's look at the process. So getting your recruitment right involves careful planning at each of the following stages. Thinking about who do you want? Thinking about where you're going to find them, how do you choose them, and then finally hiring them. How are you going to hire them and making sure, because even when you've chosen that person, getting them involved in your business at the right, in the right way is still crucial to the success of that person within your business. So let's look first at who do I want. First thing to do is to do a job analysis. If you think you've got a vacancy within your business, you need to think about who the person is, what type of job that is, what are the skills that are going to be required, and how it fits into the organisation and the budget you have for that position. There's no point in saying, right, well, I need a director, when actually you haven't got the budget to cover the money that you're going to have to pay a director. Next, look at the job description. So what are the requirements for the role? What are the responsibilities? What are you going to be expecting this person to do on a day-to-day basis and the expectations for that role? Then you need to move on and look at the person's specification. So who, what are the skills that are going to fit in? What are the attributes you want that person to have? For example, you may be recruiting an office manager and you may be a financial services organisation. But if you're recruiting a an office manager, financial services background may not be essential. So it's thinking about the essentials and desirables that are important for that role. Next, we come on to where you'll find them. So when you're recruiting, there's a number of methods you can look at. There's internal methods. So asking your employees whether they know anyone that might fit with the organisation. It's often a aspect that people don't tend to think of, because quite often there can be people that people know which can save you in terms of budgets. External methods, so advertising on your website, using methods like LinkedIn, commercial job boards, using agencies, or social media can be a great way to recruit, and social media is fairly limited in terms of budget at the moment. If you're going to advertise for your job, you need to be careful in terms of the wording that you use. If you're going to put an advert out there on a job board or in a newspaper or on your website, avoid words that could be discriminatory. So you might say, yeah, we're a young, dynamic company. Young is then putting that implication that someone who is older isn't going to necessarily succeed in that business. So you need to be aware of using those types of words. Recruitment agencies, have their place in the market, and I work with a number of recruitment agencies, but I always say that some recruitment agencies meet with them, allow them to get to know your organisation and make sure that you're getting the best from that agency, as they can be a more costly method, but they might get you the best person for your job. So there's always a bit of a caveat there. There are some agencies out there who just sort of ship off CVs that they think have got the skills, but they don't actually take the time to get to know your organisation. So it can be a waste of time and money on both your parts. Next, we'll move on to how do you choose that person? So you've now got a big wadge of CVs or application forms in front of you. How do you make sure that you get the right person for your job? So, selection methods. You might ask for application forms. Application forms can be great because they give everyone's information in a standard format and allows you to see clearly and compare one candidate against another. You might ask for CVs. CVs also have their own place, but there is more opportunity for discrepancy, or people tend to put words in white at the bottom of the page so that when you job search, then they come up with something that they haven't actually got. So CVs can be useful as well. There's also interviews. This is the most common form of recruitment selection that I think most of you use and probably have used in the past. There's a standard interview, which is just having a chat, getting to know the person, perhaps talking through their CV and experience. And then you have structured interviews, which is where you ask all candidates the same questions and get the same information. It can be quite repetitive for the person doing the interview, but it's a good way to make sure that we and remove that element of discrimination by making sure that you can say, yeah, I've asked all these candidates the same questions, this is the answers that they've given, and I can now directly compare one candidate against another. There's also assessments. So many people use things like work sample testing or assessment centres or group exercises. They can be used in much larger organisations where you might be using a number of trying to recruit a number of different positions. But things like work sampling can be really useful. I was working with a client and we were recruiting for an electrician. So we put them in the staff kitchen and asked them to re-quote for some wiring and actually got them to effectively quote in the business, which was quite a good way of seeing how they produced a quote and how that information could be used in the job that we were asking them to do. All applications must be treated confidentially and only given to those who are involved in the recruitment process. So I'd ask you to make sure that those people that are involved in the recruitment process are involved. You have different people involved at each stage, if possible, and you only share that information with those individuals. And all applications should be acknowledged. So if you get someone, there's nothing worse than applying for a job and not knowing how you've got on. Not knowing, has my application been taken forward? I'm assuming if I haven't heard anything, that I haven't, and then 3 weeks later you get a call. So always try to acknowledge the application so that people know where they are and understand what's going on and which stage of the process you're at. Once you've selected the candidates that you want to invite for interview, then you need to invite them in the right way. Now, I know that might sound strange, but it's not just a case of saying, right, Joe Bloggs, can you turn up here at this date, at this time, and meet with this person? You need to include other things. So this is your opportunity to show off your organisation. So make sure they've got access to a job description. Make sure you tell them if there's parking. Who do they call if there's any problems on the day when they're coming for a job interview? Ask them if there's any reasonable adjustments that need to be made in order to allow them to attend the interview. So, for example, I was interviewing with a client, and we had someone who, once we invited them for interview, said, actually, I can't hear. So we had to go through a process of finding a way to get that person into interview, because it's not necessarily that they wouldn't be able to do the job. The job was a developer job in an IT company. So it was a case of literally just sitting there and being able to code websites. So we found a way around it by having the managing director who was doing the interview in one room and the candidate in another room, and they've effectively had an interview via messenger chat, which wasn't ideal and perhaps took longer than another candidate, but it was a good way to get around that. And you always need to look for, are there ways around to allow anyone and everyone to apply and be successful in their job search. So you're hired. So what do you do with the chosen one? You've gone through your interview process. How do you make that happen? If you haven't done it already, you need to check that they've got the right to work in the UK. So this could be a case of bringing along passports, copies of visas, documentation that proves that they have the right to work for your organisation. Taking up references. I would always encourage people to take up references. A lot of people say they're not worth the paper they're written on. They are, because they at least prove that that person has been employed at that in that role, and quite often will say the reason for leaving if there has been a more sinister reason for leaving. Doing criminal records check, background checks, things like that, if it's relevant. And then the employment offer. So I would always encourage people to make a provisional offer subject to receiving satisfactory references and checking qualifications, things like that. The contract of employment needs to be with that employee within 8 weeks. So it doesn't have to necessarily, you could just send an offer letter inviting them to start and who they need to go and see on their first day. But they must, within 8 weeks of being employed, have an employment contract. Okay. And then joining the organisation, people kind of think, oh, well, you know, I've got that person now, that's fine. I'll see them on the first day and it's not important. If there's a gap between when you have offered them the job and when they're coming, keep in touch with that person. There is still an opportunity for them to turn around and say no, or for them not to turn up on the first day. When they get to you on the first day, think about how you felt on your first day. Think about the things that you can do to make that person feel comfortable in your organisation. Don't just sort of leave them and say, oh, read this policy. Try and have a bit of a plan that's going to bring them into the organisation, give them someone that they can talk to and go to with questions that they might have. Even simple things like showing them where the tea and coffee making facilities are. You'd be amazed at how many people don't even do that simple thing. And people are left kind of going, do I really want to work here? Do they really want me in this business? Well, you've gone to the effort of recruiting them, so I would hope you want them in the business. So show them and demonstrate that to them. And make sure that you have reviews with them to allow them to know what your expectation of them is in their role. What do you do with the unsuccessful ones? Please don't just put them on a shelf and forget about them. You need to make sure that you tell them that they haven't been successful and try and give them feedback. Those candidates have a right to feedback. So I'd always encourage you to write notes of interviews or write notes as to why you have selected one candidate over another. So that when it comes to it, you can go back to that application and you can say, right, okay, Joe Bloggs, you didn't get invited for an interview or didn't get put forward for the role because of X, Y, and Z. Okay, it could be anything. It could be the fact that they didn't have the right qualifications. It could be that they had, I don't know, a big gap in their CV that you didn't like the look of and you didn't have a chance to speak to them. I don't know, but make sure you've got notes of what that is. And then with your selection documentation, keep it for 6 months. If you keep it for 6 months, then that means that you avoid you've got that documentation. Should anyone come forward to you who has a claim and says, actually, I think you didn't put me through for interview because you thought I was too old for this role. You've then got the notes and can go back to that paperwork and say, actually, no, it was because you didn't have the right qualifications. But if you haven't got that paperwork, then you don't know. So I'd always encourage you to keep it for 6 months, and that's enough time for a claim to come in from a tribunal. So, top tips to avoid the pitfalls. Screen CVs and application forms fully. Note any discrepancies. So when I'm talking about discrepancies, I'm talking about gaps. I'm talking about things where a career has perhaps gone forward and then plateaued, or even a career that has gone backwards. Unexplained changes in jobs is always a good thing to look out for. As I mentioned, have pre-agreed interview questions means that you can then say to everyone, you have all been asked the same questions, so we are not able, you know, we're not discriminating by asking one candidate easy questions and another candidate harder questions because you like the look of the first candidate. Take full notes of the interviews and avoid what I call a memoir. So avoid writing notes on the top of the interview form saying bumpy shoes or bald head or whatever, you know, didn't like his glasses, whatever it was. Don't write it on there. Just make it sure that what you write is what they say, and then you can then say, right, I didn't like them because of X, Y, and Z. If possible, train the interviewers. Spend some time going through what you are expecting from your interviews in terms of getting the information out of the candidates you're seeing. And as I mentioned, try and encourage different age groups to be involved in the process, which then avoids that element of discrimination. And ask for copies of original qualifications so that you can then check that they are actually valid qualifications. Sometimes on CVs, people tend to up their process, or they might give themselves an extra A-level that they didn't have. So ask for those certificates to prove qualifications. And ask for the written references, as I said. So what are the costs of getting it wrong? I just want to share with you some of the Employment Tribunal statistics. So these are taken from 2013 to March. So I don't know whether you can read that at the back. It's possibly a bit small, but just to highlight some of the key figures. So the maximum award for a sex discrimination case was £168,000. The average for an age discrimination case, £18,000. Are those really costs that you can afford to stump up if you get it wrong? On the positive, if you can say it, there were tribunal fees introduced in July 2013. So anyone that wants to go to a tribunal has to pay a fee to do it. And they've also brought in early conciliation. So any claim has to go through ACAS before it gets to the tribunal. So there are barriers to people putting claims in to tribunals, but it doesn't mean it doesn't happen. Tribunal claims have gone down, but they are still there. So in summary, follow a defined process. Make sure you've agreed that process up front and you stick to it. Ensure that you plan and you set the criteria that you want for the position before you start recruiting. Be aware of discriminating against potential applicants. Think about those sort of things as you're going through the selection process and write notes as to why you're not taking them forward. Keep all notes and decision process evidence for 6 months. After 6 months, you can destroy it, shred it, because it's people's personal information, but keep it for 6 months. And make sure that they have their contract of employment within 8 weeks. Then once they join the company, induct them. Make sure that they feel welcome and are part of your organisation and that you really want them to be there. As I've just demonstrated, if you get it wrong, it can cost a lot. So how can Gemma Farina HR help you? I can advise on all aspects of pre and post employment, so getting those job descriptions involved and taking it right through to getting them on board and making sure that you've got an induction plan in place. I can help define the role that you want in your business and the person that's going to suit your business and the type of attributes you want that person to have. I'll guide you through the process, making sure that you stick to that process and that it works for your business and for the size of your business. I can help to design interview questions, making sure that you've got a balance of getting to know that person as well as exploring their technical capability. And assisting with interviews and selection. Quite often, if you're a small organisation, you haven't necessarily got thousands of people that can sit in on interviews with you, or it may be that it's a confidential recruit. So to have someone that is external that can come in and help with that, then that's always a good option. I can assist with offer documentation, making sure you've got everything there in terms of ticking the boxes, and then designing an induction program.